So if you look on the HR diagram, if you're not familiar with HR diagram, you will be very, very soon, because it is absolutely key to understanding stellar evolution and transitions. As you know, they have temperature and or spectral class plotted, because a spectral class is designated because of the temperature of the star, and either the absolute magnitude or the luminosity. The absolute magnitude being how bright these objects are if you line them all up the same distance from the Earth, their intrinsic brightness, and the luminosity is how luminous they are relative to the Sun, which is arbitrarily assigned one luminosity. So there are the various branches, the main sequence, the white dwarfs, the supergiants, the giant branch, but there are other areas that stars reside on the HR diagram, especially the ones that are transcending through variability in their stages. The Mira instability strip, as stars like sun-sized stars, sun mass-sized stars, transcend up to the red giant stage, to that branch, they go through a period where they pulsate back and forth as a Mira variable. Over here, at the very end of the red giant branch, we have the RR Lyrae instability strip, very old, low metallicity stars that have transcended all the way down to the very bottom of the red giant branch. The Cepheid instability strip, Cepheids are more massive stars that leave the HR diagram and transcend horizontally to the supergiant branch, and they go through a period of time for particular masses where they go through this strip where they pulsate in a very periodic fashion. And up here we have the semi-regular instability strip, where even more massive stars are transcending over. They might miss the Cepheid instability strip, but they will go through a semi-regular instability region before they go supernova. If you have a star that is varying in its light put over time, and you plot that change in brightness over time, you have a graph or a plot called a light curve. And these are very typical light curves. They are unique for each individual type of variability. This actually is the light curve of Mira. It pulsates 300 to 400 days approximately, one full pulsation or cycle from maximum to minimum again. This is a very unique light curve produced by an RR Lyrae star. They vary. Their period is less than a day, and they don't vary more than one magnitude. The Cepheid instability strip, again, they pulsate in a very periodic fashion. And this is a semi-regular light curve. I do believe that one's Betelgeuse. Sometimes on the HR diagram, you will see that instead of spectral classification or temperature, you will see the B minus V, the color index. The UBV photometric system was developed to try to compensate for the fact that photographic film favors the bluer, higher end of the spectrum. So you will see the color index of either U minus B, which is ultraviolet minus blue, or B minus V, which is blue minus the visible. And it has been designated that A subclass O stars are the zero point for the UVB system. So an A subclass 0 star, it has a color index of 0.0. And as the star gets hotter and hotter, it gets more and more negative. And as it gets cooler, they get more and more positive. So make sure you know what units are on the axes of the HR diagrams. Because RR Lyrae and Cepheids are very periodic, and they can be plotted on a luminosity period relationship, they can be used to determine cosmological distances in the universe to nearby galaxies. Here is a typical Cepheid light curve. Here we have a typical RR Lyrae light curve. And if you determine their period by plotting their change in brightness over time, determine what the period is, and plot them on the luminosity period chart, you will see that Cepheids have a linear relationship. The longer the period, the more luminous they are. Our Lyraes are even easier because they have such a short period of less than a day, they do not deviate very much from a straight line across the period luminosity diagram. So you can use the distance modulus, which is has three variables in it, the apparent brightness, the absolute brightness, and the distance. So if you know the absolute brightness, which you can determine from the spectra or from the luminosity, and you know the apparent brightness just by looking at it, you can determine the distance. So this works for both Cepheids and RR Lyrae in determining distances to nearby galaxies. And there is also a relationship between luminosity and absolute magnitude, so you can calculate the absolute magnitude from the luminosity chart if all you know is just the period. So the first deep sky object is T. Tauri itself, which is a variable star that is a precursor to a sun-sized main sequence star. They range in mass from approximately 0.2 to 3 solar masses. They are nascent planetary system regions, a cloud of gas and dust with a very newly forming star. Fusion hasn't stabilized yet, so they are very variable in their output. This also, V1637 Ori, is also a T. Tauri star. This one was imaged by three X-ray spacecraft, Chandra and XMM Newton and Suzaku, and put together some more interesting observational evidence for this being a sort of a toddler phase T. Tauri star. It puts out prodigious amounts of X-rays, and when it puts those X-rays out, it's also rotating really, really rapidly. It rotates in only one day. And because of all those magnetic field lines, and it's spinning faster than they are, you have those magnetic disconnection events. And that's what we see that produces the coronal ejections from our sun that produces the aurora. It's the same thing taking place here, but much more energetic and much more intense. There is a stellar nursery in M42, the Orion Nebula, called the Trapezium, where there is some, both Hubble and Chandra have done some really nice observations to show these stars that are flaring, just like the T. Tauri stars that you saw. And here is where I will give you this little caveat that, for instance, when you're studying these deep sky objects, and when you're looking at the images, don't be stuck on one or two images. Every one of these images is the Trapezium. Now, I do not go through, you know, troll through the internet for a god-awful amount of hours trying to find the most obscure, esoteric image, you know, to try to trick you with. I just go like where you go, APOD, Astronomy Picture of the Day, the major websites, Chandra for X-ray, Hubble for optical, VLA for radio, Galax for ultraviolet. I go to the very specific sites, but there isn't an image I use that does not appear in APOD, Astronomy Picture of the Day. That's a great place to look. In their archive, it gives you every major image from no matter what the wavelength. So if, for instance, if I, you know, take something like this one that you normally see a lot, this Hubble image, and I make it black but I choose one that's black and white further away and turn it, you know, right side upside down, left to right, reverse it any way I feel like it, and you can't recognize it, then you're not intimately acquainted with these deep sky objects and how they look at any wavelength or orientation. Remember, there's no up or down out there. It's all relative. And the astronomy event has three separate sections. And the first section is mostly on identifying the deep sky objects, where they're located on the HR diagram, and the basic stellar evolutionary history associated with them. And that section is weighted more than the other sections, which are more difficult, but this is the one place where you have your destiny in your own hands. if you really understand the stellar evolution and HR diagram sequences of these deep sky objects that can recognize them, then you're going to get a lot of points for that. So they're really, really important. Eta Carina, one of everybody's favorite objects, is a luminous blue variable, but it's also an S-Doradus variable. It is a hypergiant star. It is a massive star. It's one of those stars that is so massive that it can barely hold itself together. It should have gone supernova forever ago. In fact, the last time it had a massive explosion, and that's what makes S-Doradus variables different than just the luminous blue variables, because they don't just vary up and down very radically, but every now and then they have a major event where they eject a huge amount of material and then sort of settle back down. It's been about 140 years since Eta Carina had its last massive outburst, and it absolutely positively should have gone supernova at that time. How it managed to save itself, I don't know. They call it the supernova imposter phase that it went through. It managed to save itself, but it is going to go any minute, astronomically speaking, because it's very, very unstable. It started out as a 150 solar mass star. It's lost 30 solar masses. It's now 120 solar masses, and it has a 30 solar mass companion.